Hello and welcome to Queersay. I'm Andrew Kay and my guest today is James Ledward.
Good morning.
James. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you. You?
I'm good. I'm actually very good at the moment. Yes, I'm quite buoyant and I'm riding on the crest of feeling very enthused and energetic about things that are happening in the city.
Good.
There are some good news stories, mm-hmm. and I know sometimes we don't really report on good news stories here because they're quite hard to find in the global press and media. But I like this story. Our first story today is that Billie Jean King is to marshal New York's Pride. I think that's wonderful. Don't you?
Well, I have a different view on the whole thing about the people that are seen as the marshals of Pride and stuff like that. In Brighton, each year we used to have a vote as to who would be the Pride ambassadors.
Yeah.
So it was always community people. And I've always felt a little bit uncomfortable when Prides have film stars or something like that as the representative at the front of the parade, because very often the film stars or the celebrities that they've got doing that have had very little to do with our fight for equality.
Now, it just happens...
Absolutely. So with Billie Jean King, they've got it right.
Yeah.
So what I'm saying is that in principle, I've always felt more comfortable with having community people doing this rather than, you know, celebrities.
So you don't want Steve Coogan at the front of our Pride because he made Philomena. Great film. Great, great film. I think she's very deserving of this. I mean, she's been out for a long, long time.
Oh, yeah.
She's championed gay rights for a long, long time. She's put herself in positions where she's been very unpopular.
Yeah.
And she's come through all this.
I agree with all of that.
I think, you know, that she's actually the right sort of ambassador for
But sometimes they get it wrong, and that's the problem.
Well, a lot of the time, celebrities are very happy to turn out because they have a film coming out.
Precisely.
Or a new book coming out, and all of those things.
Yeah.
And again, I mean, much as we spoke on the last programme about commercial businesses piggybacking on the success of Pride to promote their business, if a celebrity is out there just really to promote what they're doing, then perhaps that isn't right.
Yeah, no.
But I think in this case, I mean, I shouldn't imagine that Billie Jean King has anything to sell anymore.
No.
Apart from gay rights.
Yeah, and she's been a good fighter for gay rights.
Mm.
But as I say, I've always felt uncomfortable when there's somebody up there who hasn't been in that position and is only being a marshal or whatever because they are a celebrity. And for me, that makes me feel slightly uncomfortable. I'd just rather that you had somebody popular from the city doing it. I mean, the most popular ones we had in Brighton was when Maisie Trollett, the drag queen,
Absolutely.
Was voted as the ambassador for Pride with some young person and Anisha from the Rainbow Chorus.
And they rode through in a limousine.
That's right,
It looked great.
It looked great, and to me, that's what Pride was all about. And so I'm really pleased that Billie Jean's doing this in America, but the downside of it is that sometimes that
do you think people will think, "Oh, I could do that"?
Well, celebrities will start thinking, "Well, that's something I need to aspire to or to do, and it'll tick my box." And that's where you need to be careful.
But we're quite lucky. I mean, we have some very big name out gay celebrities now who are actually saying the right sort of things for once.
For once, absolutely.
I mean, Elton John has been doing it for a long time. Sir Elton's been absolutely paramount in promotion of HIV and treatment and support.
Yeah.
But now Tom Daley is talking about surrogacy, and that can't be a bad thing.
No, absolutely.
I think it's really good when they get behind a genuine campaign. I can't bear the ones who bleat, the bleaters.
Yeah.
The ones who, you know, the people that... And it's going to sound disrespectful, but when Kenny Everett came out, God, he bleated. He bleated and bleated about how he was being pilloried by the media. And it was like, well, you know, Kenny, what did you expect? Mm.
But nothing's changed. Because, you know, with Tom and the surrogacy thing, when he went on Twitter and did that, he was pilloried.
Oh, absolutely.
And so, you know, nothing's changed, you know, 30 years
from that angle.
Yeah.
At all.
And that's my only concern.
But he's not moaning about it.
No, absolutely
not.
He's not
moaning about it, and I think that's really good.
Yeah.
Let's move on. There's a new mental health project for older LGBTQ people at Mind Out.
Yeah.
This is good news, isn't it?
It's good news that, first of all, the funding is going into mental health.
Yes.
It's good news that everybody is identifying that we have an ageing LGBT population in Brighton, and mental health is really the top thing that's affecting them. Whereas I would say that everybody needs to be cautious, is that we need to appreciate that we've got LGBT organisations in place for old people, and it's really important to support those organisations. And this is a piece of work that's being done by an organisation that isn't really identified as being for old people. What I'm saying is that we've got to make sure that the LGBT recognised groups for old people get the necessary support that they need. And I've got no problem with Mind Out having this money. Mind Out is one of our
excellent
blue ribbon projects, absolutely.
Yeah. I was heartened a few weeks ago. I had Bernadette from Age UK in.
Oh, yeah.
Which is not an LGBT organisation. But she came in to talk about the fact that it is an area of concern for them as a national organisation that they need to address and look after the needs of our ageing community.
Well, she gets it, you see, that's the point. And she gets it because she's identified what the problem is. And it's not a question of them chasing the funding, because there's money to go with it. They know that there is a problem with the ageing LGBT population in Brighton. And we should all be putting our minds to that. I know with the Rainbow Fund, that's what we're doing at the moment. We're looking at projects that support old people.
Isolation is a massive problem.
Absolutely,
isn't it? And I think that's the one which is the most scary, because a lot of people, as they enter their later years, when they lose a partner, do become very isolated and vulnerable.
And it happens very, very quickly.
Very quickly.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think also it's very important for people to understand that even if you don't really believe in the sanctity of a gay marriage or a civil union, you need to do it to protect yourself.
Yeah.
Because if you've not done it and you have a partner that passes away, you can end up with that person's family moving in and moving you out. And it happens all too often.
Well, just look at overnight the story. Ken Dodd died. Mm-hmm. Turns out that he married his partner of 40 years 2 days ago.
Yeah.
To protect her. And quite rightly so as well.
Yeah, absolutely. That's actually very sad. I'm glad you brought that up, but I think it's really sad news that Ken Dodd actually passed away.
Absolutely.
This week. Mm-hmm. And I met him, and he was the most charmingly hilarious, silly man I've ever met.
Yes.
But, it's good news that this project is going ahead, and you're absolutely right, we do need to start taking more care of our old community.
Yeah.
Our third story today is the same old, same old. This is about the UK government is considering a ban on gay cure therapy. It's the word considering that upsets me. Mm. I mean, what's there to consider? This is something that has to be banned.
Yeah. I don't understand why they're dragging their heels on this. I really don't. And it's something that's got to happen, and it's got to, and it will happen, but it's being dragged out, and I don't understand why. And last year we did a story exposing a church where the vicar was raping the young women to rape the lesbianism out of them. And for
raping
me,
the lesbianism out of them.
And for me, it was the most traumatic thing I've ever done in sitting down and talking this through with the victim, and then having to go and listen to the politicians who were trying to, pacify me as to why this is going. To why this is going to take time to get public opinion on side. I think with something like this, public opinion is on side, and you should just legislate and sort it out.
Absolutely, absolutely. And there is no evidence whatsoever that there is such a thing as a gay cure.
Yeah.
The only evidence is that there is intimidation and fear.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's what they're trading in.
Yeah.
Intimidation and fear.
Yeah.
And none of us should be frightened of who we are.
No.
And until the government sort that out, I'm afraid it will continue.
Mm-hmm.
And all too often, as you say, in the name of the church.
Yes, and the problem we might have is that because of the whole Brexit agenda at the moment, anything else is just being sidelined.
Yeah.
And it might well be that this Tory government feel as though they've done enough on the equalities stuff at the moment, which is why I'm concerned about the whole thing with the sex education in the schools, in that it needs sorting out. And it will be controversial because the church groups will oppose it, and I think some of the, you know, the parents in schools might well oppose it, but it's stuff that has to be done.
Yeah. And as we said earlier, you know, sex education isn't in fact sex education whatsoever.
Yeah.
But merely procreation. In fact, I think my father gave me a better insight into sex because he told me that it was really good fun.
Ah, well.
When he'd done his little scribbles on the back of an envelope of the male and female form. Mm. Thank you for that, Dad. Well, we have to go to a break now, James. When we come back, we'll be talking about Elton John and a little trip that he's been to talk to a Russian minister. But for now, some breaks. Hello and welcome back to Queersay. I'm Andrew Kay. My guest today is James Ledward. Elton John, he's been talking to Russian ministers about LGBT rights.
Well, it all helps.
I suppose it does. I mean, it didn't do any harm when he got involved with the fight for AIDS, did it?
Absolutely. No, it didn't. And the I think the motivation there that drove him was slightly different.
Yes.
My slight issue with the whole thing about personalities getting involved in politics at that level, it's like the basketball player in America that goes and has meetings with the leader of North Korea. And, we need a bit of perspective. Elton John is great, and his record is great. My concern is that everybody that's had direct access to Putin says the right things. I can remember when Andrew Marr interviewed him.
Oh, he was absolutely on side, wasn't he?
He was absolutely on side.
But the reality is very different.
And that's what's playing out with everything to do with Russia at the moment, unfortunately.
Do you think Sir Elton actually phones someone at the Home Office and says, look, I've got a meeting with this minister? Or do you think he just goes in off his own bat?
Well, he's got a from experience, he's got a big PR team around him. When we did the AIDS memorial here, his husband David Furness opened it for us, and we experienced the whole
the machine
that went with it, and it was very impressive. My guess is that he does what he wants, actually. It might well be that he does run it past somebody in government before he does it, but I think he does what he thinks is right.
I was surprised to find this story in Attitude, because I've been slightly dismissive of Attitude over the last few months.
Yeah.
In that I think it's become very much a style magazine.
Yeah.
But I was actually pleased to find some news in the magazine this issue.
Well, it's interesting. We interviewed the former editor of Attitude, Matthew Todd, in this month's G-Scene. And we were talking about his time at Attitude and the concerns that the people are expressing about the way that Attitude is doing news on their website. First of all, he was promoting his book, which was about mental health with LGBT people, and it was absolutely brilliant. But it was fascinating to talk to somebody who'd been on the inside with a magazine that for the first 15 years that it was publishing got away with not having the word gay anywhere on it.
And in fact, a lot of the time convincing heterosexual pop stars to take their kit off for, let's say, glamour spreads, which I thought was very, very weird.
Yep. But it's that whole thing about box-ticking diversity. Mm-hmm. And so I'm pleased that Elton John is still committed to the cause. I think that's what we need to say.
Yeah. And me too. I think, you know, I mean, he is a voice that is recognised globally. Yeah. And this is a global issue.
Absolutely.
So maybe it needed someone like him to just say, hang on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we can't just let this one ride. Because it has dipped out of the media at the moment. Mm-hmm. But the situation has not been resolved.
No.
So well done to him for bringing it back to people's attention. Yeah. I think that's really very good. Let's move on. Oh, I love this one. I love this story. This is wonderful. Gay escort who exposed 40 gay priests, Vatican claims they sent dick pics over WhatsApp.
Only 40?
Well, I know, we talk a lot about the church and how they need to get their own house in order. But this one is extraordinary, isn't it?
Yeah.
I know last week we talked about a group of Catholics going to the Vatican in 2019,
yeah.
The biannual mission, mm-hmm. and I was querying, why are they going? Mm-hmm. Because if you're gay and Catholic, the only purpose of going to Rome would be to seek a private audience and say, for goodness sake, Mr. Pope, mm-hmm. let's sort this out.
Mm.
Because, you know, it's beginning to be embarrassing.
Yeah.
It must be quite embarrassing to be a Catholic when stories like this are revealed to the press.
Yeah, but I think an awful lot of... what I've found is an awful lot of Catholics have taken a long time to believe these stories. But now the evidence is, you know, is so strong that people are saying... this is a real problem.
I think we say,
and we need to
we
do something
say
about
other,
it.
Other religious faiths are also guilty of
absolutely,
this.
Absolutely,
it's, I mean, it's rife, isn't it?
Absolutely. Yeah, and they got away with it for years. And I think what's really important now is the work that's being done with the Home Office to try and to go into these public forums where people are able to go and tell their stories.
Mm.
And that's where, you know, that's where we're going to get to the truth of what's been going on.
Absolutely, absolutely. I think it's really important to, and I keep saying this, that you need to shout out about these things. And, mm-hmm. and last week I decided that the phrase was, you know, happy to be out, but are you happy to shout out?
Mm-hmm.
Because there are things that aren't reported.
Yeah.
People aren't talking about being abused, about being verbally abused, about hate crime, about being attacked.
Yeah.
About, you know, also within relationships.
Mm-hmm.
About domestic abuse.
Well, that's my
and that takes place
yeah.
within the gay community.
Yeah.
Equally, you know, it's not just battered wives and battered mm-hmm. husbands mm-hmm. in the heterosexual world,
yeah.
but they exist.
That's my
the gay
big.
World.
That's my big gripe at the moment in the LGBT same-sex domestic violence stuff. I question as to whether it's being it's getting the support that it should be getting as a serious issue in Brighton. And we, as a media organisation, will be looking carefully over the next 12 months as to where that statutory money is being spent.
Mm. And I think it's very important that we actually encourage anyone who is being oppressed in that way
yeah.
to actually speak out and just say so, because mm-hmm. hiding it away, it's not going to solve the problem for you,
yeah.
but it's also not going to solve the problem on a grander scale for almost anybody mm-hmm. who in the future will... be subject to
yeah.
that.
I've been to too many court cases to report on the victims of domestic violence and seeing what plays out as part of, you know...
Well, you were asking for it. We found handcuffs that's in right. your cupboard, that's so right. it must have been your own mistakes.
Yeah,
yeah. That sort of
and
nonsense.
And it's just scary.
Yeah. Our final story, I think this is interesting. Queer Britain to become the UK's first ever LGBTQ museum.
Mm-hmm.
Did you think we needed one?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I can't wait to go. I can't wait to see what's in it.
I mean, this is my biggest concern at the moment is that there seems to be too many of the young people don't understand our history. And if we're not careful, we're going to leave all this behind. And I think it's really important that it's documented.
I think you're right about young people not knowing the history. Mm. I was in a bar a little while ago, and I saw a bunch of young guys taking the mickey out of a group of older gay
mm-hmm.
men.
Mm-hmm.
And it was winding me up, and eventually I thought, actually, you know, I'm going to go and talk to them. And I went and sat at the table and said, I don't think this is right, what you're doing, because you're yeah. clearly making fun of these people.
Yeah.
But without them, and the things that they did and the things that they stood for, your gay history... You wouldn't be able to sit in this bar mm-hmm. and have a cheap pint of lager
yeah.
at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, because bars like this didn't exist until men like that and women like that
mm-hmm.
fought for the right to be able to go out
yeah.
and lead a normal life.
Yeah.
And I think it is a it's. I know there's a bit of a love of everything being a little bit cloak and dagger and undercover and, you know, behind closed doors and all of that, but actually we've worked very, very hard.
Yes.
To not have to do that.
Absolutely.
And it would be great to see all this in place. I'm
yeah.
wondering what sort of exhibition... Did you actually get to see the Queer Britain exhibition
yeah.
at Tate last
yeah.
year? Which I thought was spectacularly
yeah.
good.
Yeah.
And, for once, an exhibition where the captioning was so well written
yeah.
and well done that it took me about 3 hours because I read every single word. And
yeah.
we would
well,
hope
when
that
it's
some of that stuff will end up.
Well,
in
yeah, when it's
like
done
this.
Properly, it really works. I was in Fort Lauderdale at Christmas, and stumbled across the World AIDS Museum, and it had the biggest impact that anything's ever had on me, because it was so well laid out, and it told the whole history of AIDS and HIV, tracing it back to 1910. And putting it in context, but the AIDS pandemic was put in context with what was going on in the real world, in real time, and showing how when there was real big announcements to be made on the HIV timeline, if it clashed with a bad news story like 9/11 or something like that, the AIDS story just sank and didn't get covered. And I think it's really important that this type of stuff now is documented, because in another 10, 15 years, we're going to lose the evidence, you know. People are going to throw their old magazines
it's
into the bins.
Yeah. I think there's an exhibition going to be at Brighton Museum of Queer Fashion. Mm-hmm. I'm working on a heritage project. Mm-hmm. There are other heritage projects in the town. And I think it's amazing that people are finally saying, let's write it down, let's keep it for posterity. Yeah. It's... great to see you.
Thank
as
you.
Always. What are you going to send to the museum? Don't tell people.
I was just thinking about
on television. They won't need to see that. Thank you so much, James, for coming. Thank you for watching Queersay. We'll be back next week with two more episodes. But for now, good night.